Welcome back to Nick Lenz's Comic Corner, classic, less known classic. This episode number 2555 and double shot number 2449. We have basically an Avengers trade here, along with a Green Lantern trade because of sci-fi stuff. We have Avengers, X-Men, Eternals, Judgment Day Companion. This book mostly collects all the side stuff for Judgment Day, plus one ongoing series tie-in. Well, there kind of is a good reason for this, and the reason why is because everything else collects their own trades, but these two issues, nope, they're not. The reason? Because they're by David Prowse. This is actually one of his first books he did for Marvel. It was a quick two-parter, which involved Obatisse, the daughter of basically Golden Mantis, a character who's come by Grant Morrison, trying to break into the Baxter building. And this Judgment Day tie-in. Yeah, and deals with her deal with Sue Storm, and potentially also that apparently that Obatisse may not be the daughter of Golden Midas. It's a very interesting two-parter. I've actually asked Dan Prowse on Twitter why would the book had to get relaunched. He said it was for marketing. Yes. But in actuality, I don't think he had any idea why in the world that this book. Now here's the thing. These are the last two issues of the previous line for the book. Yeah, because here's the thing about this particular two-part storyline. Yes, these are the last two issues published for Volume 6. Yep. And some of you might be thinking, Nick, why was this collected in the main trade? Because Dan Slott didn't write it, that's why. Yeah, and it's also found in the storyline that Dr. Midas, the one who presumably is basically been Obatisse's father the whole time, it turns out that nope, not really. She actually was adopted. Yep. I'm less upset about this than over basically Iron Man. Only thing with Iron Man, that's been very much been played down over the years. Yeah, it seems like that when Iron Man got revealed as, oh, Rick, oh, he's been adopted. It's like basically after a certain point in time, Marvel just stopped bringing that up. It's like it's not there anymore. Not really. And here's the interesting thing comes to her in this two-parter. This is the first time she's been seen since the arc her arc did in the series America. Which, by the way, though the last issue for that the this issue she here now was released in 2017. This was released last year. So this two-parter was the first time in 5 years she actually appeared in the book. And also, she created a clone of Norval. Marboy, her ex-boyfriend. Yep. Don't really know why she did this for. I found this two-parter quite interesting. You would think basically that Marvel would do a lot more with this, but they don't. That's the problem with the Midas Foundation. It's like the problem with this group is that this, I think, this is a really cool concept Grant Morrison issues in the Marvel Boys series. It's like nobody at Marvel Comics cares about this particular organization. Nope, they don't care. The only people who bother doing anything with it has been just Jason Aaron and now David Prowse. Because if you look at basically the books that they appear in, this organization, like, here's the thing. They appeared in the Marvel Boy book, Grant Morrison. Mighty Thor, that was Jason Aaron. They, of course, Obatisse also appeared in Original Sin, which was also Jason Aaron's book. The American book, she was like a recurring character in that book. She started appearing in that book as let's see, who was she in this book? Like, I think there was an alias she assumed in the book. Well, the Midas Foundation. She has Midas Foundation Superior there, but it is something, though. The fact that the whole thing with Midas is that the story is it's a guy who could transform to the gold. Dr. Midas himself, mostly put, was a low-rent think ripoff. Who, he's like a cosmic thing. He also, at one point, got his hands on the Iron Mark when Iron Mark wore a robe with it in one of the Hulk books. Yes, that's the thing with Dr. Midas. He's a weird but interesting villain. But it's like I mentioned, he's a villain that probably no one cares about. He is, the best way to say it, he's a D-lister. Yeah, he's a D-list villain, the Cosmic Man, aka Dr. Midas, who also appeared in the issue of Iron Man 2020, not the event, no, just a one-shot Iron Man 2020. Oh, the annual. Yeah, he appeared in Iron Man annual number, or flashback anyways, but he appeared in that miniseries, two issues of Marvel Knights Hulk, which was his experimental book, and he was just a supporting character in the book, and then he appeared in Original Sin, and that was it for him. Yes. But as for the other Judgment Day books that appear in this particular trade, which the other books we have are the Eye of Judgment one-shot, written by Karen Gillian. There is artwork by Pakura Ferry. Death of Mutants, which is a three-ish miniseries, also by Karen Gillian. He does the first three things in here. With Garo Forever on the artwork. Karen Gillian also has Star Fox. And, of course, it is written by Daniel Dai Nakudo. Iron Fist is done by Alyssa Wong and drawn by Michael Ying and Mark Krista. Now, this, before I bring up the rest of the stuff here, this one-shot is mostly put just the new Iron Fist teaming up with Loki for a one-shot and basically becoming friends with the Dragons of the Mark. Yeah, that's really all it is here. And here's the interesting thing related to this particular book. This is the first time that the new Iron Fist appeared since his old miniseries wrapped up. Yeah, since he became Iron Fist, which I thought this was a really bizarre idea for Marvel Comics to do. I mean, make a character who's basically a swordsman, and now he's Iron Fist. Which, by the way, after this one-shot came out, he next appeared during Chip Zdarsky's run for Daredevil. Yes. And a backup story. Yep. That was his last little appearance today. And this comic came out roughly just last year. So, who knows what Marvel has plans for this character? I mean, have I reviewed everything related that he is appearing in? Well, not really per se. I reviewed Swordmaster, the Age of Atlas book. The only thing I have not reviewed is War of the Realms, Age of Atlas, but a lot of this stuff I have reviewed. Now, there's also the book he first appeared in, which is Warriors of the Three Sovereigns. This was a... How should I put this? This was a Korean book that he appeared in, and I think that... I think, as far as I can tell, that Marvel just licensed this comic as they basically reprinted as the Swordmaster series. Yep. But the other one-shots in here, the Star Fox one is mostly, I think, just turned out to be one-shot. There is AX Judgment Day Omega, Karen Gillian, Gar Ferrer, and that's it for tie-ins. Death of Mutants is mostly put the Eternals trying to kill the mutants. Well, it's mostly put focused on, like, the first issue is most focused on the Eternals. It's, you can think of this book as, the best way to describe it, it's, despite being called Death Mutants, like, the first issue doesn't feature any mutants at all. Not really. It is mostly put them taking on the new Prime Eternal Droog. Yes. The new Prime Eternal, he's like the main villain in this book, with Kalos the Destroyer, who is like a rogue scientist. Yeah. You think a book called Death Mutants, like, oh, we have Eternals versus Mutants. Not in the first issue. Second issue features Emma Frost. It also features appearance by Star Fox. Mostly put, it's like the heroes are finding this group called the Hex. Yes, these group of aliens try to do Judgment Day on the people. Yeah, and they appear in this whole miniseries. So yeah, the whole thing of, oh, they do kill off the character Icarus. Though he comes back, don't worry. He's back, no problem. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he gets killed off this miniseries, but don't worry. He comes back, no problem. Yep. But, despite being called Death Moons, the title's a lie. There's no fighting with moons at all. It's mostly fighting against the alien group. It feels like basically this whole miniseries, like you read it and it's like, yeah, this book does not feel like a tie-in to this particular event. This feels like basically like, it's like this book is a continuation of the Eternals ongoing series Karen Gillan wrote, but without basically us rubbing against the artist. Yep. You think, okay, what about Eye of Judgment? Eye of Judgment was a prelude one-shot. Yep. It is mostly put the Lemurian mission, which basically had the people join the group. It's mostly put a lot of setup for the main event. That's mostly put exactly what this book is. Surprisingly, the one-shots for Avengers, X-Men, Heroes are not in this one, in this trade here. Nope. The Star Fox one is mostly put focused on Star Fox himself. Now, the problem I have with his new design here is that I do not like the fact they made him feminine. Star Fox, one of the coolest characters in Marvel Comics, a gem-stealing character, and they made him look like a basically a woman for no reason. Don't know why. Also, in this book, he finds out that Titan has been destroyed. His home world. You know, one of the moons of Jupiter has been destroyed. Yep. Oh, excuse me, moon of Saturn is what they have here, but in real life, I think it's moon of Jupiter. Yeah, it's mentioned been destroyed in this book. It's mostly about him reacting to the news about this. Yeah, this happens right after the Eternal Snails Rises one shot. And after this, Titan itself, next period, and Thanos Death Notes. A one shot that was done by a few different writers. But, okay, so what about the Judgment Day Omega one shot? This is mostly put an aftermath story. It's mostly put figures out exactly what to do next. It just features the Eternals, what they can do next. Features like a couple X-Men, and that's it. Yeah. It's mostly put basically, a lot of us focus on Icarus telling a woman that her sons were killed during the whole crossover. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's basically him briefly living with basically, this woman. It's mostly an Icarus book, but it is a good book overall. Yeah, and this basically is the end of it says here that this serves as a conclusion to Karen Gillan's run on Eternals and Death Mutants and the Judgment Day miniseries. So, with this particular book here, have I reviewed the entire event? No, I haven't. You're probably thinking, okay, what is there left? There's a few one-shots for Avengers, X-Men, and Eternals. Yep. Which, they're not in this one-shot. Actually, they actually have it collected in the main Judgment book. That's where you can find them. Mm-hmm. But I think I mostly, in the way, took care of the main book itself. So, I think, like, the only thing left to go is just, X-Force, Legion of X, and I believe that's it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's pretty much it. I can tell anyways what's left here. Mm-hmm. Is this a bad event? Some of you might be asking. No. was a build-up. Yes. In Eternals. The best I can say about this, but these one-shots, is that they, that they basically do artwork with it. Now, I get the reason why that the other stuff are collected here. Now, what about the X-Men, Eternals, Avengers one-shots? They're collecting the main Judgment Day trade. That's where you can find them. But what about all the other series that tie into this story? Don't worry, they're collecting their own trade, so don't worry about that. So I review a good majority of this crossover. It only came out a year ago. Almost 2 years ago it came out. 2022. Yep. It's a very interesting story, per se. And this was, interestingly enough, the only major event that happened in 2022. Thinking, really? Yes, really. This was the only, like, you could say, well, reckon anymore. That was most of a Fantastic Four. But for Lionwide, this was the only one. There was people like Dark Web, Avengers Assemble, Sinister. These are smaller events. This is the only really big event the whole year, which I do appreciate, though, Marvel did that. Because in the year 2020, we had three major events. In 2022, we had, like, we had two, because basically Devil's Reign ended in May of 2022. It started in December. This started, like, just 2 months later. At least this one did not do what Access and Original Sin, at least Access. The problem with Access, people have a problem with it, is that it starts actually 1 month just after they wrap up another cross. This one, at least they waited 2 months. Yep. Also, no delays. Yep. No delays. Everything was released on time for this book. Still pretty good book overall. Next up, by the way, I give the companion book a 9 out of 10. I don't want to give it higher than that. I mean, the Fantastic Four, I should give those a 10 because that was really good. The Death Mutants miniseries was just basically more Eternal stuff. It's still pretty good by Karen Gillan. It's interesting, Karen Gillan has almost the entire thing in that trade there except for the Iron Fist one-shot and Star Fox and Fantastic Four. All right, next up we have is Green Lantern, Kyle Rayner, Volume 1, which collects issues from Green Lantern Volume 3, issues 48 through, I think it's 4057, New Titans number 16, 17, and Rebels number 1. Now, Green Lantern, of course, are by Ron Martz. Now, the first three issues in this book is the controversial Emerald Twilight storyline. The storyline where, the story behind this particular storyline, the reason why it happened, because the book was not selling too well at this point in time, so, because normally, you know what no procedure is book doesn't sell very well? Axe it. So, that's no procedure nowadays. This book, okay, let's do something different. Let's refresh the book. Something I wish books nowadays would do this. The book is not selling very well. Do something different. So, let's have it where Hal Jordan goes nuts and murders the Green Lantern Corps and all the Guardians except for Ganthet. And 48 is noteworthy for the debut of Kyle Rayner. Yep. And with 51, basically, we start off basically his run as Green Lantern. And it lasts until the end of the run, issue 183. Yep. Now, sadly put in the case of the storyline here, we would see the death of Kilowog and Sinestro, who's briefly brought back in the storyline. It's not a terrible storyline per se, it's just that it feels a little quick. That's the problem with it. Mm-hmm. So yeah, 51, we have a brand new era here. It's mostly put basically for the first three issues. It's basically Kyle versus Mongol for the first three issues of this run. Yep. Very interesting start here. Also, 48 was debut of his girlfriend, Alex DeWitt. Which I'll get to basically what happens with her. Because right after, in the finale of this story arc, basically, Major Force is sent to murder her. Yep. by a group known as the Quandarim. Because she found out about their secrets. So let's have where Major Forrest basically just breaks into Kyle's apartment, Alex there, beat her up, and then Kyle comes along after fighting and oh, I have a surprise in the fridge. He opens the fridge and he sees the body of his dead girlfriend in the fridge. This particular image, I'm not gonna show it here because it's very controversial. This started the popular meme, Women in Refrigerators. Yes, it was a very controversial moment. Do I agree with this happening? Not really, because basically this all started a trope that has been played up to death over the years. A trope that readers hate. Killing off the female character to advance the male character. Or, this also happened to women as well. Kill off the male character to advance the female character. Yep. And of course, all my good hands on the Green Lantern ring. And then, of course, basically, then... This is weird, though. Like, the deal with Major Force, Alan Scott shows up in the book. Yes, the original Green Lantern. Which, by the way, does this book collect the Zero tie-in? It doesn't. Really? I don't think it does. Yeah, then pretty much like right after this issue here, they have Kyle go in space to deal with, there was a brand new character named Alindra, who is basically a member of the Green Lantern Corps, and then she's a one-shot character, and she briefly takes Kyle's ring, and then, of course, basically this book here leads into the first issue of Rebels. Yes, a book done by Tom Payer. A really good book. I enjoy Rebels. Rebels was a continuation of Legion. Yeah, where Viral Dox basically had his own organization turned against him by his own son, Laro Dox. Yes, Laro Dox. His smart son that at one point he had to basically lobotomize. Yes, that's Brainiac for you. Yes, the code name is Brainiac 3. Oh, and he was conceived via his mother raping Viral Dox. I am not kidding about that. And then pretty much the finale of this book is mostly put to deal with New Titans. Yep, and of course this leads into, New Titans 16 and 17. Where you have Kyren joining New Titans, but they're off in space. Yeah, and this is done by Marv Wolfman and Frank Patrice. Yeah, that's pretty much who does this quick two issues here. And of course, you also have Kyle take on Simon. Yeah, the whole reason why Kyle is in this book. Do you know why Kyle was added to New Titans? The reason is utterly stupid, because the editors wanted to force a relationship between Kyle Rayner and Donna Troy, a relationship, from what I've heard, the readers did not want that at all. No, this is by far a really dumb idea. And some of you might be asking, okay, so how long did Kyle stay as a member of the New Titans? That's a really good question here. I'm going to ask it right now. Let's see. Maybe I need it over here. Okay, he was in the book technically for 115, and he's here to pretty much issue 130, which is pretty much the final issue of the series. Yeah, so pretty much he's here up until pretty much the end of the book. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I do enjoy this book.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm going to give the book roughly a... I'm going to give it a 10 out of 10. Yeah, really a book here. I love it.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And, excuse me, some of you might be thinking, does the very next volume for new... For this book, does it contain the very next set of issues for New Titans? No. No, it does not. It skips straight to issue 124. But it does get issues of Guy Gardner and Dark Stars, which is going to be interesting to talk about that one. Yep. And there was a volume 3, but apparently got canceled. So yeah, I'll be reviewing this for a little while.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but still a good book overall. Good book, roughly, like I mentioned, a 10 out of 10. Okay, so that's pretty much a particular view. Take a little break and I'll work on One Piece next. Okay, next video. Bye.